Welcome to Talk Across America. I'm Doug Miles, and we're here in beautiful Sarasota, Florida. Joining us now, we're going to talk in our book talk segment. Man has written really a series of books that get a lot of great media out there. Very interesting books. This one is part of a series he's starting called William Shakespeare's Much Ado About Mean Girls. We're joined today by Ian Doescher on the telephone today. I believe he's out in Portland, Oregon, and he joined us by phone. And Ian, good to talk with you. How are you?
I'm doing well. Thank you so much for having me on.
Are you in Portland? Is that where you, that's where you're based, right?
Yeah, that's correct. I'm a Portland native.
Great. Yeah, and just had a chance to read through this book, and I know you put a series of these books out, pop Shakespeare books, I guess you should say, is the theme of the books, and just for the people that are not aware, you take kind of a modern theme, like a movie or something like that, and you put it into a Shakespeare type of format, and this one I have is Much Ado About Mean Girls. I know you also did another one on Back to the Future, so they both kind of come out at the same time, right?
Yeah, exactly. We're sort of launching this new pop Shakespeare series with these two books that sort of are very different kinds of movies, but both beloved.
I know you did also the Star Wars, right? Series of Shakespeare before this?
Yeah. I've done eight William Shakespeare Star Wars books, which tell the stories of the eight main episodes in the Star Wars franchise.
Yeah, you started that, I guess, about 4 or 5 years ago, and those did so well. And what gave you the idea to branch out into the, like this one is the one I have again, Much Ado About the Mean Girls. It's a film that, I guess, teenage girls loved, and of course everybody remembers Back to the Future back in the mid-80s, but how do you choose the other ones other than the Star Wars?
You know, ever since the Star Wars book came out, there's we've been discussing and talking about and sort of imagining which different movies might work in a Shakespearean context, and you know, I mean, the reality is that just about anything that has a good following and has good characters and a good storyline would probably work because, you know, Shakespeare was writing the popular stories of his time. And so any movie that, you know, that is popular is probably going to work pretty well.
Yeah, I guess you're right. People tend to forget. I just forgot that Shakespeare did kind of took things out of, you know, maybe not the headlines, but what people were talking about back then. So he was current for the time of what was going on, wasn't he?
Yeah, exactly. He was taking a lot of the stories that were around in his time and rewriting them. So, yeah, exactly.
Now, the first time you did it with the Star Wars, and again, for people who may not aware, you write it as Shakespeare may have written it in a play, and using a lot of the iambic pentameter, that style of speaking back then. So was that something you had gravitated toward by reading Shakespeare yourself, or how did you learn to do that?
Yeah, so when I was in high school, my freshman year in high school was when I studied Shakespeare for the first time, and I was a theater kid, and I loved... you know, so I loved his sort of rich characters and his interesting stories, and I also at the same time I loved learning about poetic meter because I'd always been fascinated by things like Dr. Seuss or poems like the "Twas the Night Before Christmas" that all have these sort of rigid meters to them that are so fluid. And so it was that combination; it just sort of hit me at the right time. And it was also the same time that Kenneth Branagh was coming out with some of his Shakespearean movie adaptations. So it was really a good time to be a young person getting into Shakespeare.
Yeah, I remember having to study that in high school as well, but it wasn't quite as fun in our class. You found a fun way to do it, right?
I did, and I also recognize that I'm kind of one of the lucky ones, right? It doesn't always, you know, people don't always love it as much, and it sort of came naturally to me, so I was very lucky in that regard.
I think that the key is, you know, when you're reading it, it can be kind of dry, but if you see it on stage, and we did get to see a production on stage somewhere, then it makes a little bit more sense to you. So you're understanding what the meter is all about and all that. So, well, now the iambic pentameter, again, that's that kind of rhythm of the speech back then, how he wrote it. Is that difficult when you adapt it to, you know, the modern day writing? Of course, Mean Girls wasn't written that way, or nothing was written that way. That's written more in slang, I guess, Mean Girls. But how difficult was that for you?
I mean, when I first started writing iambic pentameter in grade, you know, a lot of at a time with the first Star Wars book, it was definitely a challenge and took a lot of getting used to. But it's kind of like exercising a muscle. The more you do it, the stronger it gets. So, you know, over time, writing an iambic pentameter has become much easier to me. It's almost second nature to me at this point.
Yeah. And then the Mean Girls, I guess you had to see the movie, obviously, or get a script somewhere to be able to kind of adapt it, right?
Yeah, so what I do is I can find the script is online for any of these movies, and then I sort of watch the movie slowly, you know, taking a little bit of dialogue at a time and adapting it into Shakespeare's style and looking for opportunities for sort of literary devices or other things that Shakespeare might have used. And then just continue on with the movie slowly but surely and make my way through the whole thing.
Yeah, it's a great idea. And I know also, just kind of reading through the notes, I guess some schools have kind of approached you, or at least your books, maybe some English teachers are using them to teach Shakespeare, right? Is that true?
Yeah, so my books are being used as sort of a bridge into Shakespeare by some teachers. So they will have students read some or all of my books. And you know, the benefit of it is I hope that it's a familiar story. You know, the kids are familiar with Star Wars or Back to the Future or Mean Girls. And so they're not learning a new story. They're getting something they expect. But they're also being introduced to at least some Shakespearean elements, you know, the iambic pentameter, literary devices, vocabulary a little bit, you know, that sort of thing. So that hopefully then when they make the leap into real Shakespeare, it's not quite as big. They sort of have a bridge into Shakespeare as opposed to just diving in head first. So that's, you know, that is how the books have been used by schools, and it's always an honor to me for when that happens, because I love the idea that somehow my books are being used to help kids get interested in Shakespeare.
Yeah, I wish we had those when I had to take it. So I think it breaks that reluctance anyway. You know, it's very difficult to read if you have never seen it before. But
yeah,
if you have something you're familiar with in that style of writing, obviously that's going to make it easier when you have to read the plays of Shakespeare. So that's a great idea.
Yeah, for sure.
Now, obviously, you know, you've studied Shakespeare. Do all of his plays you use? You know, all of his plays adaptable to these types of books?
Yeah. You know, at one point or another, I think I have referenced, because I do include Shakespearean references in my books. You know, a character will be saying something, and then they'll sort of use a snippet of a line from Shakespeare.
Right.
And I think at this point, I've used references to just about every single Shakespeare play out there.
Yeah.
I try to be pretty broad.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah. Well, again, this one is Much Ado About Mean Girls, William Shakespeare's Much Ado About Mean Girls. You also have William Shakespeare's Get Thee, Back to the Future. I should say the title correctly, of course, based on the film Back to the Future with Marty McFly and Doc and all that. Great idea there. And we've been talking with Ian Doescher today. Ian, give out your website. People get more information about the series of books.
Yep, I'm at iandoescher.com. It's Doescher. And also quirkbooks.com is my publisher, where you can find a lot of other information there.
Great. Ian, pleasure talking to you. Hopefully we can do it again I'm sure you're working on others in the series, and love to have you then. But thanks for being with us.
All right. Thank you so much.
Thank you for joining us today on Talk Across America. Please visit our website at DougMilesMedia.com for more great interviews and content. And if you're interested in any of the books we talk about on the program, please click the Amazon link on our website. It helps support the podcast. Thanks for listening. We'll see you again real soon here from beautiful Sarasota, Florida.
I'm Stan Brock. 30 years ago, I formed Remote Area Medical to help people overseas. But then we found generations of families in America, isolated by poverty from the healthcare they need. Together, we can take dental, vision, and medical help to 1 million adults and their kids, right here at home in the United States of America.